Congratulations on the Ernest Dean Beer Award. What was it like to you to receive an honor like that?
Well, I'm just so honored because, especially because it's Ernest Dean Beer Award, and that represents to me, you know, advocacy for women. She was a leading force in getting women's competition in the United States, and women and men before her that have advocated for women and helping to contribute to my life so greatly. Rowing has, through my life, meant so much to me, played such a big part. And I'm just so thankful that there were people that were willing to take the time and energy and sometimes battles to get women the same positions as the men, having competitions and eventually to be able to go to the Olympics. And I was at the 72 Olympics. I was actually watching my coach and my future husband in a double. And at those Olympics, the IOC met, and that was when I learned that women would be in the Olympics in rowing, in the 1976 Olympics. So we've come a long way, and I feel very, very honored to receive this award.
Following in a pioneer's footsteps, you're a pioneer yourself. You were the first woman in the United States to medal at the Olympics, and a silver medal in a very difficult competition. What were you thinking? How did that feel for you as you were going through?
Well, it was the ultimate thrill. You know, I think I discussed with you over the phone that in 73 I had won the singles trials to represent the United States at the World Championships that year, when it was a European Championship. So beginning as far back as 73, and then 74, 75, I had, you know, been the singles scholar, competing in the World Championships, and it had always been in Europe, in a different continent, and the times, you know, dealing with the time zone, borrowing a men's boat, usually a boat that didn't fit me, the training, break in training, and a lot of difficulties, financial difficulties as well, even getting to the competitions. And so to have this culmination in 76, to be in the Olympics in Montreal, where it was on our continent, didn't have to suffer from time zone changes, had a boat that fit me, it was a woman's boat, and my parents were there, family and friends from Long Beach, which I hadn't had before, people to see me. And I was able to take off a year, well, almost a year, 6 months of school. I had was no longer, didn't go to school or to work for 6 months. I'd never had that luxury or opportunity. I'd always been going to school. And later worked full-time even after the 76, before the 80 and 84 Olympics. But it was a thrill to get a silver, especially against the, you know, East Germans dominating those Olympics. I'm not sure you're aware how much the East Germans dominated. East Germany and Bulgaria won a few, but so to come in second, I mean, you want to win, but I was out in the windiest lane. I was in lane six, East Germany in lane two, Russia in lane one. Now, the Eastern Bloc countries were pretty much the dominant forces at that time. And it was thrilling to be not too far off.
Fast forward a bunch of years later, you're still in rowing and you're still contributing. You're starting the Learn to Row program, you're getting a master's into the sport, and you're still competing yourself. What does this all mean to you?
Well, first of all, rowing is my passion. I love rowing, and as many people that are into rowing, I started it with people that were supportive of me, but people offered to teach me to row for free. I never paid for coaching. Throughout my whole career, I've never paid for a coach, and I had the top coach, Tom McKibben, who really advocated for women's rowing. He was the first Olympic women's sculling coach, was a coach of four Olympic teams after that, was an Olympian himself, was a world champion in the double sculls. And so what it means to me is he gave his time and energy and shared his passion with me and instilled in me a motivation to take advantage of the opportunity, if it comes along, which fortunately it did, to train to be the best you can be, see how good you can be. And through trying to see how good you can be, it involved learning the best techniques, learning from masters, finding out what is the best technique, what makes the boat move for you, and the training, all the training, the latest training at the time that was possible. And so what it means is that I want to give back and share with other people that are new to rowing, especially to sculling, to let people understand that sculling is a lifetime skill, that not always is rowing a lifetime skill. If you learn to sweep row and you don't ever get in a single shell, and you don't have an opportunity to get an oar in each hand, and it takes some time to learn. So I hope that people will have the opportunity to scull. Then if you can scull, you can sweep. You can do anything if you can scull, especially if you're proficient at sculling. And so what it means to me is giving back as much as I can, sharing the sport, sharing my passion, because others did that for me, and it's given me my life. I have friends, I've had reunions with people I started with in the 1970s, on my first national team in 1972. I've had reunions with my 1984 Olympic quad team, and it's just, you know, these lifetime bonds, but also you find people that maybe for different reasons, pathways they chose, maybe jobs or families, or they moved away from the sport and they weren't able to row all their lives. And I find some of them, I know, I see that there's a little bit of regret that they left rowing. And so I feel very fortunate that I was able to stay in. I chose to stay in. There's more lucrative careers probably that I chose, but I'm really happy that I did choose what I did. I'm a physical education teacher, was able to share the passion for physical activity, whether it's rowing or not. It wasn't always rowing, but just to find a passion, an activity you love to do.
Your personal perseverance has brought you a long way in life. You're fighting another battle now. How are you? Where are you, and what kind of support are you getting from the community?
Oh, well, I have brain cancer. It's glioblastoma, GBM, multiform. It's an aggressive cancer. I guess you could say it's incurable, but there's working for cures. So I've had treatments. I've had two brain surgeries and radiation and chemotherapy. I'm currently on chemotherapy, two chemotherapies. So I've had that treatment for the last, since September 2013. So this is, December 2014. So it's been a while. But the support from the community, as I've mentioned, I've had reunions of it. People contact me that I rode with in the 70s. And my 84 quad came back, and I don't know if that's the reason that they really made an effort to get together. And so that support has meant a lot to me. It's really made me realize that I think how important rowing has been to me in my life and my relationships, my friendships. Especially with the people I rode with, but also the people that I've met just on national teams and the coaches. I've made more connections with my coach, my longtime coach, Tom McKibben, who coached me through all my years of competing in the single. And it's the support has been terrific. It's a really important part of just staying healthy and well. So I think I've been lucky.
How do you stay this upbeat?
Well, I think you can cry. Crying about it is just wasting time. I mean, I just feel I have a wonderful life. And when I was in the hospital for the times that I was in for surgeries, and you see how bad it can be, how lucky I've been. I've been healthy until this. I've been healthy all my life. I've just been, been able to compete at a high level. And I just feel so fortunate to have what I've had. If it all ends tomorrow, okay, well, I've had a great run. But I hope it'll continue. And I just find, how do I continue to be upbeat? I mean, you have times when you're sad. I think I feel sad for my husband, for my loved ones that are caring for me, especially for my husband. But I've just been so lucky because I have a wonderful husband. I've had a wonderful family, and I've been lucky. So I stay upbeat because I've had a lot of good fortune in my life.